During that time, entertainment was great.
I would say we had that type of music which made old people and young enjoy.
We entertained people as far as North Rhodesia then. And I think it was a wonderful experience.
First, it was the type of a cappella music where people just used to sing without any musical accompaniment or instrumental accompaniment.
We sang, we used to sing some songs from records, you know, from the Mills Brothers and even from a group called the Crew Cats. We used to sing a song called Chiboom. I don't know if you've heard it, Chiboom. We used to sing Chiboom. It's Chiboom, Chiboom.
And then we also used to sing some Negro spirituals and jazz, blues. You know, we grew up singing all those songs when we were still young.
Music has no bounds. And I don't think there's any vehicle that really can get people of different cultures together. And we did it here with music.
You know, we used to call it Amaradi in Gabon. Or in English, they used to refer it as Jai. You know, they used to call it the Township Jai.
Urban drift in the 1930s to the 1960s of black people from their communal lands to look for jobs in the towns created an early urban culture which had little or nothing to do with a particular ethnic group. Among the first townships to be established were Harare, Naumbare, and Makokova in Bulawayo. The most popular and prestigious recreation center in Harare was Maimsozi Hall, named after Maimsozi, a well-known social welfare worker. And in Bulawayo, township entertainment was centered at Stanley Hall, Makokova. The Bantu actors were one of the first organized choirs in Central Africa. Their history dates back to 1932, when a group of young boys, students at Domboshava Training Center, formed a singing troupe under the guidance of a teacher. One of them, Kenneth Mataka, went on to form the Bantu actors. And from the ranks of Bantu actors sprang such great musicians and performers as Moses Mpahlo Mafusire, Sani Sondo, Jonathan Shieza, Safirio Madzikatiri, Jeremiah Kayenga, and others.
There are many people that we used to sing with when we were young. Okay, some of the prominent names include Smangaliso Tutani, who we used to meet when singing. Thomas Mapfumo, I remember Thomas Mapfumo used to come to our house when he was young, when he was doing Form 2 at the Harare Secondary School. I still remember that very much. And at that time, he was a fan of Elvis Presley. So he used to sing a lot of Elvis Presley songs. Safirio Madzikatire, I used to see him when I was young again. I think it was in the early 50s when he used to be with my father's musical group, which was called the Bantu Actors. Moses Mpasho is a very famous leader of the D Black Evening Follies. He also used to sing with the Bantu Actors. We also have Sani Sondo, who used to be with the City Quads. He also was with the Bantu Actors. So we've got all those names of people whom I used to see as a small child, you know, singing with my father. But of course, later on, most of these people developed their own musical groups.
I met Mr. Mataka, and he got interested in me. I actually got most of my singing background, or my experience from him.
And I should thank him very much.
What happened was I was singing soprano, my mother was on the alto, my father was either tenor or bass, and my brother was playing either the guitar or the piano with a backup band. Now, we used to travel to a number of parts throughout Central Africa as a family singing. And of course, at one stage in the mid-50s, the Bantu actors were also there. At times it would be the Bantu actors on one hand and then the Mataka family on the other, you know, as two separate groups. In 1959, we ran a 13-week program at the Mbare Studios. It was a radio program called Meet the Mataka Family. This program was produced and directed by Ephraim Chamba. It was a 15-minute weekly program which ran for 13 weeks where the Mataka family, backed by the African Talent Band, you know, ran a musical program.
Around about the same time, township entertainment was also taking off in a big way in Bulawayo, and the merrymakers were at the forefront.
And we had choirs singing in the streets. Then we decided when the municipality gave us the standing hall, we had to stage some concerts in the standing hall. And from the standing hall, either we went to the Roman Catholic Church. There was a hall where we used to have our concerts there. Then as time went on, a few choirs sprang up. It was quite a good listening. They, I would say, we had that type of music which made old people and young enjoy. For instance, we used to sing this song, Elokishini. Now, this was about the life in the location, Bulawayo, where we used to stay. Then we told that story in a song so that people understood, and so that people understood what was going on in that time. If we play that song to you as youngsters, you find that you'll enjoy it. A song like Elokishini, we could sing it to you, but unfortunately, you know what it is. Our songs were sung in four parts, but now we are only two of us, me and my wife. I'm a good wife. I don't know whether we'll give you satisfaction. But anyway, we'll try. Give us the code, Mama.
Elokishini, Elokishini, oh, my Asibunji, Mama Elokishi, Eukonenku. Nukuye makaya elokishini kukone nobuti abasebe nukuye makaya elokishini kukone zintombi zingasafu nukuye makaya Sengi katele ngale lokishi Sengi kiniwe Nese benzi yayo O maye man Nyoku tinina Ngoba leli ngeba Lebo shungu
You can excuse us, the voice has gone rusty. From that time up to now, the voices also get rusty unless we go to the garage for oiling up, lubrication and things like that.
Then in the 1940s, a group of young men led by Moses Mpatlo Mafusiri broke away from Bantu actors to start their own band and named it Deep Lake Evening Follies.
When we broke off from Bantu actors, we decided to form our own group, or rather start our own group, and we named it the Black Evening Follies on the 10th of September, 1943. So we then started practicing. We had a lot of rehearsals, and eventually we decided to stage our own show. To start with, we thought probably we're not going to make it, but the very first show that we staged was a very, very successful one.
Here they come, the Black Evening Follies from Salisbury.
Any songs, I mean, which became popular at that time?
I wouldn't say we used to write music as such. What we used to do is we used to take, say, about two, tunes, and we combined them together, and we then composed our song from those two tunes.
Now, some of these songs were composed by my father. Others were songs that were originally in English, and my father would put them into Shona. Some songs were songs, let's say, from down south, that they would adapt and put Shona words. When it comes to other songs that I remember my father translated into Shona, there's this song called Rumors Are Flying. Perhaps I can sing one stanza from that. It used to go like this. Rumors are flying, and I'm not denying that I'm in a crazy kind of haze.
So what were you?
As I go walking, I hear people talking that our affair is just a passing phase. Now, my father put that Shona, that word, that song into Shona, and of course he put different words all together. And in Shona it went like this: Komado keru, kone moyo wangu, nichifamba nemudikanwi wangu, shiri zesango, zichibururuka, zichiti kwatiri rufaro rudo. Now that song was popularized by the Black Evening Follies, by the Deep Black Evening Follies, led by Moses Impasho, and I must admit that it's a beautiful piece. You know, it was well presented.
Now, through the advent of the radio and the gramophone, we also had the welfare office binning some music from loudspeakers in the children's parks. So we had quite a lot of music in the township. That also influenced our music. Since Zimbabwe was the headquarters of the Federal Broadcasting Corporation was in Lusaka. So we had quite a lot of music from Malawi and Northern Rhodesia, Zambia now. So also from this station, because Zambia was very much interested in Zairean music, so we got a bit of that as well. And we had quite a bit of influence from South Africa, from the records. Record companies like Gallo had opened up. People had gramophones, you know. We used to see a few American groups on film. At Miami Swazi, there was cinema every Saturday and Sunday, I think. No, every Saturday. So we'd see pictures of groups like the Mills Brothers, the Nicholas Brothers, who were doing a dance routine. And that was quite a bit of influence on us, so that even our music changed later on to what I call township jazz.
Man who actually was very fond of composing songs was the late Sani Sondo. When he joined the Black Evening Follies, he was still very young. But I actually picked him up for the sake of his voice. He had a very lovely voice. So we decided that we should give him the leading part when we actually perform. Most songs were led vocally by Sani Sondo.
The late Sani Sondo, in my opinion, was the greatest entertainer Zimbabwe has ever produced. You know, Sani Sondo, he was a comedian. He could dance. When I said dance, he could dance enough to help him along. And he had a fantastic voice, beautiful voice. And to me, as an entertainer, and he was a comedian, he could tell jokes. He could sing. He was an all-rounder. There is nobody today in Zimbabwe who is on stage who is comparable to what Sani Sondo was.
Well, unfortunately, he decided to break his membership with the Black Evening Follies in order to start his own group, the City Quads. So as far as the City Quads were concerned, we were only four. The four friends were the two late gentlemen, Sani Sondo, Titus Mkotsanjera, and then Pei Mtunyani, and myself, Sam Matambo.
We cut a long-playing record. I think it was the first long-playing record we cut in the township. It was called Music in the African Township. The numbers were, if I'm not mistaken, about 12 of them. And they were very popular. One of our numbers there was banned, which was called Lizofika Ninilanga. This sounded to be political, because at that time the struggle was on. The political struggle was on, like I said. So when I was now working for the broadcasting station, the then senior master asked me to play that record only if I explained exactly what it was all about. Well, Lizofika Ninilanga was sort of a prayer song, shall I say, a Negro spiritual. Spirituals are all prayer songs anyway. It was a spiritual of the African people saying, when will the day of freedom come?
A lot of money when you were in showbiz?
Oh, no. Well, we it was not money making at all. It was just entertaining, because admission was sixpence shilling, if you remember that, what it was that time. And if we went higher than that, it would be, say, 5 shillings, and 10 shillings would be perhaps the highest we ever asked for at the door. So we made no money at all. If we did make any money at all, would give it out to charity, or it would cover our expenses. And to buy instruments, we had to put hands in our pockets, because we were part-time performers. We were working at the time. 6 o'clock, we go for practices. Up to 9 o'clock, we break and go home. So it was very costly to us. Mm-hmm. We raised money for charity. This charity involved charities like the Jairus Jiri and the schools, Runyararo, little kids, and various other schools and churches.
We enjoyed it. We liked it. We enjoyed it so much that if people had said to us while we were walking along the streets, can you come and sing for us, we'd go there and sing. We sang at people's weddings. See, there were people who said, who were friends of ours, who said, look, I'm getting married. Can you do me a favor? And he said, fine.
During that time, entertainment was great. There was a time when funds were being raised for Nyatsime College. We also took part in that, but the greatest part was taken by the late artist, world-famous artist Louis Armstrong, who performed at Glam Stadium. Everybody liked his jazz, and even today he goes down very well with songs on his long-playing records.
When Louis Armstrong got on the stage, you could actually see that he's actually serious. He meant business. Oh, he was a wonderful chap. Very, very wonderful indeed.
People say, Louis Armstrong sings Kokena, which was originally from a Zimbabwe jazz musician. Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, that was a song that was composed by the late Augustine Msarurwa. To start with, he was a member of the police band. And he composed the song. It was a wonderful song. Augustine Msarurwa was a talented saxophone player. Mm-hmm. And that actually made his song very, very popular, because the way he actually played a skokian on the saxophone was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Many musicians have done versions of Musarurwa's great composition, including Yuma Sekela and Paul Lunga, who still plays music with the jazz impacto in Bulawayo, home of many pioneer musicians, such as the Cool Four.
Mazukarisa Ushabela, equal and rhythm crooners. Tatesuya gets Karisa, Cool Fours. Who Cool Four Sitkale in 1950? Cool Four. Status Shabela, Guaba Yimi, Upeni Pulablan, Guaba Lolabi Tolda, Guaba Lomako Mafumu, Guaba Loneva, Nevada, Love, Guaba Lofostin, Presley. Bonke laba ibonge ngihlabela nawo abanye bangakhona uneva siwabhubha lo Faustina siwafa lo Marco siwafa sokwasala ulaki lami yikho ke kuze kube leso sikhathi sesiloko sihlabela ijazz. Affectionately known as Dot, Dorothy Masuka's musical career started in South Africa when she was at school. She featured with stars like Miriam Makeba, Dolly Ratebe, and the saxophone maestro Kipi Moketsi. Back home, Dorothy Masuka sang with almost every band which was around in the 1950s. The Golden Rhythm Crooners, the Cool Four, just to name a few. In the 50s, Dorothy Masuka recorded more than 20 singles with Gallo. One of her most popular songs was Nonsokolo.
At that time, Dorothy Masuka was very, very popular. And of course, incidentally, Dorothy Masuka happens to be my mother's cousin. We had Dorothy Masuka. There was also Flora Dickey, who came for a short time. She was with some group. I can't remember which group, but I remember every Friday we used to go to my Mzozi Hall, not to see Flora Dick sing.
There was Valerie Govenda, who was later Mrs. Edwards. She was very good. She was more like in the version of Ella Fitzgerald. The late Faith Doughty, I shouldn't forget.
Faith was in great demand elsewhere. Faith was with the City Choirs, she was with the Blakeney Follies. I think she even did with the Golden Rhythm Crooners at one stage. But she would always be available to us. And for a period, of course, she was the star of the Milton Brothers. And she gave the group a certain element of class, so that every time we staged a show and Faith was there, you could be sure that a lot of people would come to hear Faith, because she had a fantastic voice. She had also a fantastic personality. Okay, she was short, you know. We called her the shotgun boogie because she was short. But she had the real presence, you know, when she got on the stage. Just the, you know, when the first note that she sang, people sat up, or people started clapping. So with Faith Doubt, we had Amandeva Bere, which was, well, a composition to some extent, although it was taken from a tune that had been popularized by a South African singer. Toya Chingate from the Gay Gaieties. At their time, they were quite a hit. I mean, here was an all-female group, you know. During that time, it was quite something to see a group of women, just women, without any men.
Our group was called the Gay Gaieties. The nurses we had, they were the first group of nurses, actually. So I thought, well, now, these poor girls, they don't know what they are missing. Because it can be much pleasanter not to just look at patients only, but to have an outside entertainment. And when we sang, again, we got a very big ovation. People were interested in our music. One friend of mine decided, oh, well, let me hear this. What is this? I hear Mrs. Chingati is singing. A woman, what is it like? So she came at Maim Sozi Hall, where we had a concert. And when she came there, she came out and said to me, ah, I came to see what a woman can do in the public like this. But it was nice. I thought there was nothing wrong with it. And then there was one play we had to do. This was a musical play. So they asked us to join with the city choirs. And I was singing a duet with Mr. Sunny Sondo in that play.
What was the duet called?
Have I told you lately that I love you? Could I tell you once again somehow? Have I told you I'd like to spend my life forever? I can't remember.
Then Salisbury's wife, Sylvia, she also was a singer in Follies, and I think she formed their own group at one stage. Then there Joyce Ndoro. Joyce Ndoro, of course, was good. She was a former Miss Harare.
Now, Joyce, in a song entitled Gori Gori.
During our performances was actually a variety program. We used to have a quartet. We used to have a whole group of, say, about six people performing at the same time. Then we used to have sketches, what we used to call sketches, sort of plays in between.
Yeah, I'm going to go. Yeah.
In a group, a singing group, you would have a clown. We had the Mishek. I forget his surname. Mishek, tall, dark man. There was Mishek, there was Chabata, and there was Four Pence, Magaisa, Ibenje, or Magaisa, but this was Ndinda. If you're following him, he indicates he's turning right. If you think he's turning right, he's turning left. You have to be very careful when you're following him. He was so clownish. He was the bread eater of a certain group.
If you hear the nickname Magaisa Ibenze number two, the great bread eater, he's a man who was maybe it was a drought at that time too, that somebody think of eating bread to survive. So I was actually eating bread in order to live. And it became popular, and then it goes on the stage. And then we tore the Federation of Rhodesia and New Zealand around all the Blantyre in Lusaka and coming back to the so-called Salisbury before. There were hundreds and hundreds of people coming to see how what they called Magaisa, eating three loaves of bread in 5 minutes. And sometimes they said, why can't you go and compete the other people in the other world who eat bread? But I said I was the only bread eater in the world. There was nobody who was going to compete with me.
After eating three loaves of bread in 5 minutes, did you drink something?
If a day is a good day, you know, without the clouds upstairs, you go for three loaves of bread and five Fantas. But if you go for Fantas only, you go up to 18 Fantas at one time.
Welcome once more to Music Time. This is Ali Kinkata's All Star.
Was a very good man, an awfully nice man, and I think he was extremely good on the broadcasting. But then he moved up to what was then Northern Rhodesia, to the Kitwe studios, because that's where the federal broadcasting tapes were kept. And many years later, I worked with his younger brother. Now, Alec was killed, I think it was during the Liberation War, wasn't it? He was killed in Zambia by a bomb. Oh, Alec was absolutely splendid. I mean, first class as a vocalist and a band and performer.
The one-man band musicians also played an important part in the early urban entertainment. Popularly known as Omasiganda, a name derived from a corrupted form of the word musicant, an Afrikaans word for musician. The pioneer Omasiganda entertainers traveled up and down the country playing to diverse audiences. There were Josiah Hadebe, George Sibanda, and Sabelo Mate. These three were among the earliest musicians to record with Eric Gallo in the late 1940s. There was also Jacob Mungu, who became popular with his song Chengeta Wabereki, and John White, who entertained mainly on trains.
We have a well of vent on Telo Mangang Alizer. We have a well of vent on Telo Punyang Alizer. We have one is your young one Telo Mangang Alizer. Hey, Hamba, when she see you on Telo Kunyan, Alice. Send Petile, Imu John White, Igava Zili Dal, and after Zango, Koti.
The poetical stratus especially, you know, brought in a certain element of originality in their Shona music.
The Epwe theatrical status, which I understand was a family group, it was very, very good. Their music, I think, originated from a church background. And then they usually focused on social issues. They would sing songs where they are advising people not to smoke, for instance, or not to drink. Wah, wah. Hauna kunaka, unotipinza mumatambuziko, songs like that.
While musicians were belting out music and songs of love and hope, race relations in Rhodesia were far from harmonious. The city and town centers were the exclusive domain of whites, as far as entertainment was concerned.
Well, during those days, I remember, it wasn't an easy thing to get into the white community and sort of entertain the whites. It was not a very usual thing.
Racial barriers were absolutely tremendous, and the Interracial Association was started in the early 50s to try and break down the color bar and to persuade whites that blacks were human beings. That was really it. Mm-hmm. And we were always short of money, and so as part of our fundraising attempts, we tried to put on concerts. Now, at that time, there was tremendous interest in Harare, and Highfield was just beginning, really, in music. And South Africa, of course, had been leading the field, but there were a number of good people in Zimbabwe. I mean, people like Alec and Carter. And then there was Moses and Pashta and the City Quartz, and Sonny Sondo. And we did several things. For example, one year, We were trying to persuade whites that it was all right to open restaurants and tea rooms and so on to people of all races. Because after all, this was federation, and we were supposed to have a policy of partnership. But nothing had happened.
Acadia Rhythm Lads broke new ground by venturing into the city center, which in those days was not allowed, in the sense that we had what they call the equivalent of the Group Areas Act in South Africa. And blacks were not allowed into the city center as far as entertainment was concerned. Coloreds, people of mixed race like myself, we were allowed with sufferance, but we were not allowed to entertain. And but we defied the law. I talked the other three chaps into organizing a concert for the city center. And when people saw our posters, we had a crowded concert, I remember. The fire brigade had to come. The chief fire officer had to move people out because it was hazardous, fire hazard. And by the time the police realized that we had a multiracial show here with whites, coloreds, blacks, Indians, it was too late. Well, music has no bounds. And I don't think there's any vehicle that really can get people of different cultures together. And we did it here with music, with the result that a place like Acadia, where no white men used to visit, eventually they started coming to the Acadia Community Center to listen to us. Mm-hmm. And no harm befell them, so it just proved what a fallacy it was that you're playing with your life if you went into non-white areas.
Sometimes we used to play to mixed crowds. Sometimes, you know, when we had concerts at, at the Federal Hotel, we used to have a mixed audience because we had university students, both blacks and whites, attending. In fact, it was one of the few places. Later on, Bika Brothers opened a restaurant, which was also a place where, you know, people were multiracially mixed.
But with the end of the Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland and the introduction of the state of emergency, the political situation grew more and more tense. And in the townships, the music and entertainment slowly fell by the wayside.
The political situation became quite difficult. So we, all of us, the three of us, in fact, ended up in northern Rhodesia at the time.
How do you see today's music and entertainment?
Unfortunately, I don't go to these musical shows very much. They are different from what we had. You know, what we had, if you went to a concert at Manson, there was the stage. And you, the singers, the entertainers, were on stage. The audience was there. They sat quietly listening to you. They came dressed up, you know, in their best. I mean, people brought their wives, their mothers-in-law, you know, to a concert, which went on from 8 o'clock to up to 11:30 or something. And it was an evening that it had a lot of class. I mean, if you said you're going to a concert, you really believe that you're going to have a good time.
Not this type of music we're hearing today, because a good number of us don't appreciate listening at this music, which is we are hearing today. That's why, no wonder why you find that quite a lot of us old people don't attend concerts, whether it's a choir from the overseas or from South Africa. We will not even go there. It would be a waste of time.
I should say today's music, particularly
when I sort of turn on the side of African traditional music, I should say we are doing very well.
Culture is dynamic, culture is not static. You keep on changing because of the influences, you know, around you. Now, because of that, there's been lots of changes in music. You know, more and more songs coming up, more and more variations. Like, for instance, in the 60s, we started seeing rock and roll coming in, and then later on we had people like Chubby Checker introducing the twist. And then in the 70s, there were more and more changes, and today we're now talking of reggae and so forth. So because of the change in culture, we have to accept that, we have to appreciate. Admittedly, I don't appreciate all of the music that we have today, you know, but then I've got to accept it because things have got to change.